Ezekiel chapter number 45. For you that are here tonight, it's been a couple of weeks, been actually a month since we've been in Ezekiel. If you're watching by way of the video, the archive, you saw last week, you know, you saw a study, and you don't realize it's been a month between then and now. And a lot of things have happened. We had the Bible conference. We had a number of things happening in connection with that. We had I had a little health event that kind of took me out for a couple of weeks. So we're coming back tonight. For us, there's been a delay. And I'm going to look at some things in chapter 45 that might not pick up exactly with what you saw last time in the video. But it's going to be what it is. I want to look with you tonight in chapter 45 about the fact in the kingdom, in the tabernacle of the kingdom of the millennium that Ezekiel is talking about here, they're going to celebrate two festivals that Israel celebrated. Israel had seven in Leviticus 23, they had seven annual feasts, festivals. Started with Pentecost, goes all the way to tabernacles. In the millennium, they're only going to have two. They'll have Passover and tabernacles. And there's a reason for that. And that's what's here in this chapter. Now, if you start in chapter 43, just to give a little bit of review to catch us up so that you know that we do know that we've had some previous studies. In chapter 43, you'll remember in verse number 7, when he talks about verse number 4, the glory of the Lord came into the house by way of the gate. Ezekiel has seen God build the tabernacle. The Messiah builds the temple and the tabernacle in the land. He separates the land of Israel and he puts the temple in it. And now the glory of the Lord fills that temple. Verse number 7, he said unto me, Son of man, the place, and underline that word place, the geographical location of my throne, and the place of the soles of my feet, where I will dwell in the midst of the children of Israel. That temple, that place, that temple is the place where the Lord Jesus Christ is going to dwell. It's the geographic location where he's going to place his throne. This is where the Lord is going to govern and run the universe, the cosmos from. He's going to put his throne, his government, right there in Jerusalem, in this temple, in this location in the Middle East. And that's where it's going to be. And verse number 12, when he talks about that place, this is the law of the house. Upon the top of the mountain, the whole limit thereof, round about, shall be most holy. Behold, this is the law of the house. This place right here where he dwells is called holy ground. And it's the most holy. It's the most set apart place on the planet because he's there. You remember in Exodus when the Lord appeared to Moses in the burning bush. He said, take off your shoes for the ground is holy ground. That's where God is. And that holiness, that set apart for his dwelling, for his throne, where he's going to be. That's where he's going to reside, and that's why it's holy. It's set apart. It's sanctified ground because of Jehovah's presence, and it's important to understand that because all the things that you're going to see, verse number 43:13. These are the measures of the altar, and he talks to you about the altar. Verse number 19, he begins talking about the offerings and the sacrifices that are there, and you notice. Verse 19, thou shalt give to the priest, the Levites, that be of the seed of Zadok, which approach unto me, to minister unto me, saith the Lord God, a young bullock for a sin offering. And thou shalt take of the blood thereof, and put it on the four horns of it, of the altar, and on the four corners of the settle, and upon the border thereof, about, thus shalt thou cleanse and purge it. Notice that the blood is for the purpose of cleansing and purging, making holy the altar. It's a fascinating thing. All through the sin offering and all the rest of the offerings that are here, the blood is not put on the people. The blood is put upon the altar, the different things in the altar, and the different placements. The sacrifices are to make the place where the Lord is to make it proper for Him to dwell there, and to sanctify that land, for it to be His dwelling place. If you go down to verse number 25, 7 days shalt thou prepare every day a goat for a sin offering. They shall also prepare a young bullock and a ram out of the flock without blemish. 7 days shall they purge the altar and purify it, and they shall consecrate themselves. Now, how does a priest consecrate himself? You remember Exodus chapter number 29? They go out and they wash, the baptism. Then they're anointed. The Holy Spirit comes on them. And then there's the sprinkling of the blood. So there's a preparation for the priest to do his work. And part of his work is going in and purifying, making acceptable the place for God to dwell there. And when these days are expired, it should be that upon the eighth day and so forward, the priest shall make your burnt offerings upon the altar and your peace offerings, and I will accept you, saith the Lord. So when they sanctify the place, then he says, I'll accept you because that place is acceptable for us to meet. Now that's how they get the initial situation set up. Chapter 44, you have the prince. Then you come to chapter 25, and you have the land, the place where the prince is going to live, and so forth. And if you come down to chapter 45, verse number, well, just start in verse number, maybe start in verse number 17. And it shall be the prince's part. Now, the prince is David. It's interesting that David's doing this. David was a king and a prophet, but he also functioned in Israel as a priest. And he's the perfect picture of the Messiah. And he's going to be the prince that represents and does these things. It shall come to pass, verse 17, it shall be the prince's part to give burnt offerings and meat offerings and drink offerings in the feast and in the new moons and the Sabbaths, in all the solemnities of the house of Israel. He shall present the sin offering and the meat offering and the burnt offering and the peace offering to make reconciliation for the house of Israel. Now, I'm going to talk to you a little later, probably next time, about all these different sacrifices, because the big question is, why do you have all these sacrifices in the millennium? But I want to do that. But before we get to that, if you can understand why these two feasts are there, it helps you understand the sacrifices. And by the way, verse number 18, thus saith the Lord God, in the first month, in the first day of the month, thou shalt take a young bullock without blemish and cleanse the sanctuary. The sacrifices, you remember Hebrews says that the blood of bulls and goats can't take away sin? Well, then the blood of bulls and goats weren't taking away sin. People say, well, they were a picture. They couldn't have been a picture of taking away your sin because they didn't take away sin. And they can't be a picture of something they didn't do. God didn't give illustrations, pictures, similitudes of things and say, this is what it looks like if it didn't, what it didn't tell the truth. So there's a misunderstanding, a fundamental misunderstanding about some of these sacrifices in the Old Testament, about what they were to do. Hence, there's a misunderstanding about what they're teaching in the millennium. And it's important to kind of back off and see some of that. Verse number, you notice what it's making reconciliation for the house of Israel. Thus saith the Lord God, verse 18, in the first month, in the first day of the month, thou shalt take a young bullock without blemish and cleanse the sanctuary. So what are they cleansing? They're cleansing the place, the house. They're making it fit for them to meet God there. The priest would take the blood of the sin offering and put it upon the post of the house and upon the four corners of the settle of the settle of the altar, and upon the post of the gate and the inner court. So thou shalt do every seventh day of the month for one that erreth, and for him that is simple, so that ye reconcile the house. And I just want to keep emphasizing that issue about we're reconciling the place where God's at. We're making that place a place where they can meet with God. Now, verse number 21, and in the first month, in the 14th day of the month, ye shall have the Passover, a feast of 7 days, unleavened bread shall be eaten. And upon that day that the prince prepare for himself and for all the people of the land, a bullock for a sin offering. And 7 days of the feast, he should prepare a burnt offering to the Lord, 7 bullocks and 7 rams without blemish daily, the 7 days, and the kid of the goats daily for a sin offering. And thou shalt prepare a meat offering of an ephah for a bullock, and an ephah for a ram, and a hen for of oil for an ephah. So they're going to observe the Passover. And then verse 25, in the seventh month, in the 15th day of the month, shall he do the like in the feast of 7 days, according to the sin offering, according to the burnt offering, according to the meat offering, and according to the oil offering. So on the first month, the 14th day of the month, that's when they celebrate the Passover. You go back to Exodus 12, and you see that, Leviticus 23, that's the date of the Passover. But then you get to verse 25, the seventh month and the 15th day of the month, that's when they celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles. Those two feast days are the two feast days that they're going to celebrate. Now, the celebration is going to be a little somewhat different in its details as it is in Leviticus. But the point is, in the millennium, they're not going to celebrate all 7 of the feasts that Israel kept in Leviticus 23. They're just going to do the first one and the last one. Now, the reason for that, it seems to me, is that the first one, Passover, is about Israel's deliverance from Egypt. Okay? What are they being delivered? They're being delivered from the satanic policy of evil that held them in spiritual bondage in Egypt. Tabernacles is the celebration of the harvest. It's the celebration of the blessings of God's delivering Israel into the blessings of his covenant with them. Come with me, if you will, to Deuteronomy chapter 6. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 23, you know, we quote Romans 6:23 a lot. Years ago, I got the idea about preaching that the 6:23 is in the Bible. And it's fascinating how many 6:23s are interesting to preach. This is one of them. Deuteronomy 6:23. For me, this is probably the clearest verse about the Exodus. Deuteronomy 6:23. And he, that is talking about the Lord, verse 22, the Lord showed signs and wonders great and sore upon Egypt, upon Pharaoh, and upon his household. Before our eyes, he brought us out from thence. He brought us out from Egyptian bondage. Why? That he might bring us in to give us the land which he swore unto our fathers. So why did God bring them out of Egypt? To bring them into the land. Two things. He brought us out of Egypt. He brought us out of the bondage. And you remember when God tells Pharaoh, let my people go? And then he waits because he puts 10 plagues. And the Bible says that what God was doing in those 10 plagues is he was judging the gods, little g's, of Egypt that held Israel in bondage. And he judged the gods of Egypt, the gods of the nations, delivered Israel from that satanic captivity, that policy of evil to hold God's people, delivered them by blood and by power, by the blood of the Lamb. Then he brought them to the Red Sea, and by the power of God took them across the Red Sea. Come with me to the book of Exodus chapter 14, just so you can appreciate what's happening here. Exodus chapter number 14, verse number 30. And Exodus 14 is where they come to the Red Sea. The Red Sea is opened up. Verse number 13, Moses said unto the people, "Fear not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. And the Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace." And so what God does is he opens up the Red Sea, and Israel goes across on dry land. And then when Pharaoh and his armies follow through, the walls come down and destroy them. And verse number 30, "Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians upon the seashore." Somebody said, "How did they know the Egyptians were dead?" And the answer was, they saw their head and shoulders upon the beach. That's how they knew they had dandruff. Now, that's a bad joke, but there they are. They see them dead. And Israel saw that great work which the Lord did unto the Egyptians. And the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord. And it's sort of, for salvation, for Israel, salvation was something they could see. It's a physical thing because he's delivered them. But he didn't just deliver them physically, he delivered them spiritually. Chapter 15, then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, "I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea. The Lord is my strength and song. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare him an habitation. My father's God, and I'll exalt him. The Lord is a man of war." The Lord is his name. Jehovah is his name. And he's a man of, he's going to come and fight and deliver us. And when he says there in verse number 2, "I will prepare him a habitation," come down to verse number 17. The rest of this is the continuation of the song. "Thou shalt bring them and plant them in the mountain of thine inheritance, the place, O Lord, which thou hast made for thee to dwell in, the sanctuary, O Lord, which thy hands have established." That's what we're reading in Ezekiel. When he talks about bringing them into the mountain of thine inheritance, we talk about that high mountain, this place where God's going to govern the cosmos from, his throne. He's placed it right there. And there's this sanctuary, this dwelling place that he's established. In verse 18, "The Lord shall reign forever and ever." It began, what's happening in the millennium began back here with the Passover. So when you get in the millennium, they're going to celebrate the deliverance that God is providing through Israel from the satanic policy of evil. By the blood and by the power, by the majesty of his power. Now when he brings them out of Egypt, he doesn't take them immediately into the land. He takes them into the wilderness. And he does that because there are some lessons they need to learn about who he is and what he's going to do for them. When he takes them into the wilderness, if you look over at chapter 15, Exodus 15, verse number 22, after all this wonderful deliverance, Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea, and they went out into the wilderness of Shur, and they went 3 days into the wilderness and found no water. Now, there's some reasons he doesn't take them directly in. One of them is that the Edomites say, "You can't come this way." And so he takes them into the wilderness. And when they get there, there's a problem. And there's going to be 5 different accounts between here and chapter 19 of God takes Israel. There's no water. So you know what he does? He provides water. They go to Marah and the water is bitter. And he provides a way to make heal the water. They go the next, there's no water, strike the rock, and the water comes. God teaches them. The name Jehovah means I am. Then there's a blank to fill in the blank, as it were. I am whatever you need me to be who I chose you to be, I'll provide that for you. I will deliver you, and I will provide for you everything you need to be for you to be the people I've chosen you to be. And he teaches them, and there are five specific lessons that he gives them in Exodus 15, 16, 17, and 18 about the provisions that he's going to make for them. And then they go out into the wilderness because of their unbelief. And he demonstrates to them in that wilderness, the wilderness is controlled by the satanic policy of evil. That's where God's people aren't. That's where Satan, that's where the gods of the nations run things. And they go out there, and he demonstrates to them that he will deliver them. He'll protect them. He'll sustain them all during that when they're surrounded by their enemies, by spiritual forces that hate them. And he'll deliver them from all of that satanic attempts to destroy them. So the wilderness is unholy ground where God doesn't dwell. But he's going to dwell in his people. And he's going to deliver them from that satanic policy of evil against them, from the death and the hostility and the land that the gods operate. And he demonstrates that to them. And then he brings them in to the land. Now, the goal of that is I brought you out. I'm going to train you. Then I'm going to bring you into the land. That's what Tabernacles is about. The Feast of Tabernacles is the Feast of the Harvest. Look with me at Leviticus 23. The process of getting from Passover to Tabernacles, you're there. The process is over with. The Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast of Pentecost, and all the rest of them, trumpets and the atonement stuff, that's the process. The promise is going in. The purpose is to put my people in the land. And now it's been accomplished. They're in the millennium. And so they're going to celebrate the proclamation of God's deliverance, the purpose that he has in taking his people and putting them in the land. And now they're going to celebrate the product of that, the goal of it. The Feast of Tabernacles is generally described as the Feast of the Harvest. Did you know that the pilgrims, when they landed in Plymouth and did all that stuff, and they established the first Thanksgiving, that what they were doing was celebrating the Feast of Tabernacles? If you go back and read their history, they were celebrating the Feast of the Harvest. But in Israel, Tabernacles was not just that we got a good harvest. It's that we're harvesting the result of the promise God had for his people. Because now the land produces crops. So the land has produced a crop. But spiritually, now the land has produced a people who are going to inhabit that land. So it's more than just, we got a good crop. Now we have the harvest of God's promise to put his people in the land. So the end goal is the harvest of the fruit of the land, where the nation is going to dwell in that land. Chapter 23 of Leviticus, verse number 39. Also the 15th day of the seventh month, when you have gathered in the fruit of the land, you shall keep a feast unto the Lord. 7 days. On the first day shall be a Sabbath, and on the eighth day shall be a Sabbath. And you shall take you on the first day the boughs of goodly trees, and branches of palm trees, and the boughs of thick trees, and willows of the brook, and you shall rejoice before the Lord your God 7 days. And you shall keep it a feast unto the Lord 7 days in the year. And it shall be a statute forever in your generations, and you shall celebrate it in the seventh month. And ye shall dwell in booths 7 days. All that are Israelites born shall dwell in booths. For your generation may know that I made the children of Israel to dwell in booths when I brought them out of the land of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. And Moses declared unto the children of Israel the feast of the Lord. The feast of booths, tabernacles. That is, they're celebrating the fact that God brought them out, allowed them to live through the wilderness. And when it says booths, that word booth, look over with me in Isaiah chapter 1, verse number 8. That word that is translated booths, sir, we use a booth sort of like a phone booth or something like that. But it's more than just that. Isaiah chapter 1, verse number 8. The daughters of Zion is left as a cottage in a vineyard, as a lodge in a garden of cucumbers. A cottage in a vineyard and a lodge in a garden of cucumbers. That's not a phone booth. That sounds like a pretty nice place to be. That word cottage is the same word that's translated booths over there in Leviticus. And the idea is that God provided places for Israel to dwell, to be protected, to be taken care of. And what you're celebrating in the tabernacles is you're celebrating the fact that God provided a way for us to dwell in the promised land. So tabernacles is celebrating the deliverance, not just that he delivered us out, but now he's brought us in. And we're going to thank him for the harvest, for planting us in the land. Now, I want you to see one thing. Come with me to Numbers chapter 29. There's a fascinating thing in Numbers about the Feast of Tabernacles. In fact, it's a strange thing. And when you read commentaries, they read it, they go, we don't get it. And I understand why they don't get it. But in Numbers 23, the sacrifices that are offered on the day for the 7 days of the Feast of Tabernacles. Numbers 23, verse number 12. And on the 15th day of the seventh month, now that's the beginning of the Feast of Tabernacles, ye shall do no servile work. It's a Sabbath day. Ye shall keep the feast of the Lord God, the Lord, 7 days. Now watch. Ye shall offer a burnt offering, a sacrifice made by fire, of sweet savor unto the Lord, 13 young bullocks, 2 rams, 14 lambs of the first year. They should be without blemish. So on the first day, they offer 13 bulls. That's a lot of bull. But it gets better. Come down with me, if you will, to verse number 17. On the second day, you shall offer 12 young bullocks. Verse 20, on the third day, 11 bullocks. On verse 23, on the fourth day, 10 bullocks. Verse 26, on the fifth day, 9 bullocks. Verse 29, on the sixth day, 8 bullocks. Verse 32, on the seventh day, 7. If you count all those numbers up, in those 7 days, they offer 70 bulls in sacrifice. And you say, what in the world would require 70? I mean, that's a lot of bloodshed. That's a lot of livestock. So what's the deal there? Well, that number 70 is very significant when you consider the gods of the adversary who are attacking the nation Israel. Go back with me to the book of, get Deuteronomy chapter 32 in one hand, and go back to Genesis chapter number 10. Deuteronomy 32 and Genesis 10 and Romans 1. If you get those three passages, just for time's sake. Deuteronomy 32, Romans 1, and Genesis 10. We've been over this many times, and you'll understand that as we do it. In Deuteronomy chapter 32, when God's talking to Israel through Moses about his plan and purpose for the nation Israel. Verse number one, give ear, O ye heavens, and speak. I will speak, and hear, O earth, the words of my mouth. My doctrine shall drop as the rain. My speech shall distill as the dew. This chapter is called the Song of Moses. And Moses is going to give the doctrinal history of his nation, why God chose Israel, what he's going to do with them, how he's going to accomplish it from beginning to end. In verse number 7, he says, remember the days of old. Consider the years of many generations. Ask thy father, and he shall show thee, thy elders, and they shall tell thee. You remember Isaiah chapter 40, he says, have you not known from the beginning? Well, they had, because God had told them, and generation after generation after generation kept the next generation up to date. So he says, ask anybody. They know why God created the nation Israel. They know why he's the rock. They know why he's created the nation. When the Most High, verse 8, divided to the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. Now think about what that's saying. There was a time when God took the nations of the earth and divided their inheritance to them. He separated them, and he used the number of the children of Israel, which is 12, to make those divisions. That's why in Revelation, that's why you have 12 apostles who govern the 12 nations, the 12 tribes are going to judge the 12, govern the 12 divisions of the Gentile nations. That's why you have 24 elders in Revelation 4, because there's the 12 divisions on the earth, 12 in the heavens. All those, that's governmental perfection. But then in verse number 9, the Lord's portion in all of that is who? None of those nations, the Lord's portion is Israel. God separated the nation Israel out from the nations. He gave them their inheritance. He literally abandoned them to be ruled over by the little g gods that they preferred as opposed to him. And that's what happens at the Tower of Babel in Genesis chapter number 11. When the nations of the earth, the whole world was of one language. Now, the whole world is in chapter 10. And if you go through chapter 10 and you count those nations, Brother John back there did it for me some years ago. You know how many you find in John chapter in Numbers, Genesis chapter 10? 70. So originally there was a division of 70 nations. 70 gods placed over those nations. And God says, you want the little g gods instead of me? Okay, I'll give you your inheritance. I'll let you have them. The reason for that is what chapter 11, the Tower of Babel, and God separated them. Now, Paul describes that for you in Romans chapter 1. When he says in chapter 1, verse number 21, that because when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fool, and changed the glory of God into of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, the birds, the four-footed beasts, creeping things. Isn't that an interesting verse? You always make a God that you can control. Eventually the one you can step on. De-evolution. But then notice the next verse. Wherefore, because of their rejection of God, God gave them up. You don't want me? You see, God doesn't have to work up a sweat to take care of people. Just leave you to yourself. Verse 26, for which cause God gave them up. But then verse 28, and even as they did not like to retain God in knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind. He literally handed them over to the satanic policy of evil. But what did he do? In Genesis 12, he called out one man, Abraham, and formed a nation out of Abraham that's his portion, his people. So he separates Israel out as my people from all the nations of the earth. Now, that separation, the 70 nations, one nation up here. Now, by the way, those 70 nations have the 70 gods that rule them. That stuff is multiplied because each one of those gods has fostered other gods under them. So there are myriads of gods in the world today that govern various aspects of the nations. But there's this hierarchy in that satanic policy of evil. We've talked about the spiritual realms, principalities, powers, dominions, and so forth, the rulers of the darkness of this world. There's a structure of little g gods, angels, who are given the responsibility of governing in the creation. They're fallen angels, they're rebellious angels, but they still have these jobs yet. But God formed the nation Israel for the purpose of reclaiming his intention of ruling in the earth. In the millennium, the Lord Jesus Christ comes back, and what does he do? He comes back and sets his throne on the earth and says, this is the place where I'm going to rule the whole cosmos from, right here. So they celebrate Passover to celebrate God's deliverance of Israel from that satanic policy of evil. They're going to celebrate the tabernacles to rejoice in the fact that God is now exercising and bringing, he brought us out, that he can bring us in. Now come with me to Zechariah chapter 14 and watch this take place. Zechariah chapter 14. In the kingdom, what happens? Zechariah 14 verse 16. It shall come to pass that everyone that is left of all the nations which come up against Jerusalem even shall go up from year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, to keep the Feast of Tabernacles. And it shall be that whosoever will not come up of all the nations of the earth unto Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, even upon them shall be no rain. So in the kingdom, they're going to worship, they're going to observe that Feast of Tabernacles. And all the, it's not just Israel, it's the nations. And I've been saying to you all along, the purpose of the sacrifices, the purpose of all these things, and you've got redeemed Israel. And Israel, the commission, is go ye therefore and teach all nations all things I've commanded you. So Israel is going to take the things that God gave them and teach the nations the lessons that those things taught them. So they're going to teach the truth of tabernacles. They're going to celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles, and the Gentiles are going to come and join them. And the remnant of Gentiles that believe and trust and identify with the Lord Jesus Christ, the King, will be involved. And the ones that don't, well, that's the ones that follow Satan at the end. But all through that millennium, they're going to have the opportunity to rejoice. And by the way, that's why there are 70 bullocks over there. I mean, those 70 bullocks on the that Israel's offering back there, so why are they offering 70? Because that's the promise that God gave to redeem those Gentiles through his plan with the nation of Israel. You remember what the Abrahamic covenant is? I'll bless thee, and through thee all the nations of the earth be blessed. God didn't save Israel just to save Israel. He saved Israel to make them the vehicle through whom the nations of the earth are delivered. Delivered from what? Delivered from satanic captivity. Delivered from the lie. Not just delivered from their personal sins, but delivered from this spiritual activity and war against the God of creation, the God of Israel. Go back to Zechariah 14. Just notice how this happens. You see the first three verses? Behold, the day of the Lord cometh. This is future. The day of the Lord, his second advent. Cometh, and thy thy spoil shall be divided in the midst of thee. And I will gather all nations against Jerusalem to battle, and the city shall be taken, and the houses ravished, and the women, the houses rifled, and the women ravished, and half the city shall go forth into captivity, and the residue of the people shall not be cut off from the city. That's bad. That's a tribulation. The enemy's going to come in like a flood and try to take Israel away. Then shall the Lord go forth and fight against those nations, as he fought in the day of battle. Back there in the book of Joshua. And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem. You remember where Jesus left from in Acts 1? When he comes back, first time he puts his foot on the ground, it's going to be the same place. So he's returning. He's coming back. He's going to come and destroy his enemies. And if you go through verse 4, 5, 6, and 7 and 8, you see it's going to transform the whole, not just the earth, but the whole cosmos, the whole of the universe. Verse 8, it shall be in that day that living water shall go out of Jerusalem, half of them toward the former sea and half of them toward the hinder sea. In summer and in winter shall be, and the Lord shall be king over all the earth. In that day there shall be one Lord. And his name, one, Jehovah. And by the way, his name is Jehovah. It's not Yahweh. I'm amazed at how often I hear people now say Yahweh. Yahweh is a modernistic perversion that comes from German rationalism in the 1800s. Has nothing to do with anything anybody tells you about Hebrew being Y. You don't say the Yod. People say, well, Hebrew doesn't have a J, but English does. Duh. Do you say Jerusalem? Do you say Joshua? Do you say Jericho? Well, then you ought to say Jehovah. Amen. If you don't want to say Jehovah, quit saying Jerusalem, quit saying Joshua. Quit using the J. You see, you've let unbelieving scholars change your Bible. And the most evangelical, I listened to the radio the other day, John MacArthur's doing it, all these great evangelical leaders, they couldn't find the Word of God with a flashlight in the Bible they're using. Somebody's telling me today about using it. Where my grandkids go to school over here, Fundamental Independent Baptist Church, Bob Jones Feeder School. They use the ESV, English Standard Version. It's in the pew of their church, Schaumburg Christian School, Bethel Baptist Church. The ESV, pick it up. I did. Look at the copyright page. It's a revision of the Revised Standard Version. Every time you buy one, you put money in the coffers of the National Council of Churches. Dr. Bumpus, that started that church, fought against the National Council of Churches. Bob Jones University used to fight against the National Council of Churches. Now Bob Jones and that school and church use a book produced off of the National. You say, what's going on? Spiritual darkness, blindness. And I know people say, well, you got them, those old folk, King James Bible people. Well, I don't care. Call me whatever you want to call me. I got sense enough to know when I see a crook, he's a crook. I don't care if he's got on a clerical collar or not. So, how did I get off on that? I'm sorry. I was talking about Jehovah. His name is Jehovah. And is that where in your Bible? And when you hear Yahweh, just go, I'm against the channel, and change it. It ain't Yahweh. Settle down, Richard. Anyway, the whole issue here, when you get down to verse number 16, there's this universal commendation, celebration of Jehovah's victory, his deliverance. of his creation. He's the king. He's the Lord of hosts. He's the Lord of the armies of heaven. And those 70 bullocks foreshadowed the deliverance of the Gentiles. You see, in verse 16, it's the Gentiles are joining Israel. Israel is teaching them. Verse 20, in that day there should be upon the bells of the horses holiness unto the Lord. And the pots in the Lord's house shall be like the bowls before the altar. Yea, every pot in Jerusalem and in Judah shall be holiness unto the Lord of hosts. And all they that sacrifice shall come and take of them and seethe therein. And in that day there shall be no more Canaanite in the house of the Lord of hosts. God's going to take that thing and make it all his. One other passage. Come over to Amos. Come back to Amos chapter number 9. I just want you to see that in that kingdom, the reason that thing's the way it is because the Lord's going to accomplish his purpose in restoring his creation back under the headship of his Son. And those sacrifices have to do with rejoicing in that and teaching the Gentiles that truth. Amos chapter number 9, verse number 11. In that day, and that's the day, if you go back to verse 5, the Lord God of hosts is he that toucheth the land, it shall melt, and all that dwell therein shall mourn, and it shall rise up wholly like a flood, and shall be drowned as by the flood of Egypt. It is he that buildeth his stories in the heavens, and hath founded his troop in the earth. He that calleth for the waters of the sea and poureth them out upon the face of the earth, the Lord is his name. He's going to bring his people. He's going to bring his throne. He's going to control his universe all through the stories of heaven. Put his throne on the ground here in Jerusalem. Verse 11, in that day I will raise up the tabernacle of David. David's the prince that has fallen, and close up the breach thereof. And I will raise up his ruins, and I will build it as in the days of old. I'm going to fulfill my covenant with David, the Davidic covenant, the kingdom covenant. He's going to fulfill it. That they may possess the remnant of Edom and all the heathen which are called by my name, saith the Lord that doeth this. When he says, I'm going to possess the remnant of Edom, you remember Edom? Ezekiel 25, Ezekiel 35. They had that ancient hatred. That's the seat of the ancient hatred against the Abrahamic covenant. And God says, even them, I'm going to possess that remnant. He's going to have victory over it all. And they're going to celebrate Jehovah's superiority over all things. Everything's going to be under his control. They're going to be aligned with the God of Israel. And by the way, the God of Israel is incarnate in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because the Jehovah you're reading about that is Jesus Christ. What a day that's going to be. Those things are going to be used by Israel to teach the Gentiles, to convert the Gentiles, so that they then can go into the eternal kingdom, fulfill the commission in Matthew 28 and the purpose of the Abrahamic covenant. So that's why those things are there, and it's fitting that they would be. Brought us out to bring us in. Okay? All right. We'll stop there and do some more damage next week. All right. Father, we thank you tonight for your love and your grace. We thank you for our Savior. We thank you for one that would love us enough to be our Savior. And one whose magnitude and superiority above all creation, whose wisdom that produces it all, is the one whom we can love and appreciate and follow. We thank you for that privilege in Christ's name. Amen.